Hello and welcome to our lecture on diabetes mellitus. We'll start off by talking about the pancreas, which is an organ located in the left hypochondriac region. Then we'll move on and cover the hormones released by pancreas. After this, we'll shift our attention to diabetes mellitus, in which we'll cover the pathophysiology and the symptoms associated with diabetes mellitus. And finally, we'll finish off by discussing some diagnostic tests. So let's get started. Pancreas mainly has two functions. One is the exocrine pancreas and the other one is the endocrine pancreas. The exocrine portion of the pancreas is made up of acini, which are cells that release digestive enzymes, which help to digest the food that we eat. We'll cover the exocrine pancreas in more detail when we'll discuss the gastrointestinal physiology. In this lecture, we'll be focusing more on the endocrine portion of the pancreas, which is responsible for regulation of blood glucose levels. So the endocrine portion of the pancreas is made up of a cluster of cells called the islets of Langerhans. The central part of the islets of Langerhans contains the beta cells, which secrete insulin in response to high blood glucose levels. Insulin then functions to lower the high blood glucose by storing it so it can be used later on when your body needs it. The peripheral part of the islets of Langerhans contains the alpha cells, which secrete a hormone called glucagon in response to low blood glucose levels. Glucagon, as opposed to insulin, then functions to increase the blood glucose levels, and usually this hormone is released in states of fasting or starvation. And just for a side note, normal blood glucose levels are tightly monitored between a range of 80 to 100 mg per deciliter. Let's move on to discuss exactly how insulin and glucagon achieve their effects. This will make it easier for us to understand the pathophysiology of diabetes when we'll cover it later on. Insulin generally functions to increase glucose uptake in most cells of the body, especially the liver, muscles, and adipose tissue. Additional functions of insulin in the liver is to convert glucose and store it as glycogen, and also to prevent any further formation of glucose by inhibiting gluconeogenesis. Similar effects of insulin takes place in the muscles. For example, glucose gets converted into glycogen so it can be stored, and in addition to this, formation of more protein occurs as well. Finally, insulin acts on the adipose tissue to increase the formation of fat, and insulin also inhibits the enzyme lipase, thereby preventing any further breakdown of fat. So basically, insulin is providing the body an overall anabolic state. Let's shift our attention to glucagon. Glucagon, as opposed to insulin, does not have many receptors in the body. The main receptors of glucagon are present in the liver and adipose tissue. In the liver, glucagon functions to break down the stored glycogen and release it as glucose. Glucagon also stimulates gluconeogenesis in the liver, which increases the formation of more glucose and also inhibits any further breakdown of glucose. So basically, it's trying to raise that blood glucose levels in whatever way it could. Another effect of glucagon in the liver is to break down protein into amino acids and fat into free fatty acids. These compounds are then further catabolized, thereby generating more energy. Glucagon's effects in the adipose tissue is to break down fat to free fatty acids, which can then also be used to generate more energy. So to simplify, glucagon provides an overall catabolic state, just so your body can fuel its basal metabolism. Alright, so now we know the functions of insulin and glucagon, let's go on to discuss diabetes mellitus. Diabetes mellitus is a metabolic disorder. It is characterized by abnormally elevated blood glucose levels. In this disease, the body loses its ability to regulate blood glucose levels. This could be due to either decreased insulin production, where the pancreas are not producing enough insulin, or it could be due to increased insulin resistance, where the pancreas are producing insulin, however, there is decreased sensitivity of the body to the hormone insulin. And some of the times you see that the cause of diabetes could be a mixture of both. There are three main types of diabetes mellitus. There's type 1 diabetes mellitus, there's type 2, and we have gestational diabetes mellitus. In this lecture, we'll be focusing on type 1 diabetes mellitus, and the consequent lectures will cover the other types. Type 1 diabetes mellitus is commonly seen in children. What happens here is that your body is not producing enough insulin in response to rising blood glucose levels. The reason behind this is autoimmune destruction of pancreatic beta cells by type 4 cell-mediated immunity. Let me explain this concept in more detail in the next slide. Here is our pancreas. Remember earlier we mentioned that the pancreas contains islets of Langerhans, and located in its center are the beta cells, which secrete insulin in response to high blood glucose. So the T cells of your immune system, which are normally responsible for attacking foreign antigens, think that the beta cells of the islets of Langerhans are foreign, and they attack them instead, causing destruction of beta cells. This over time leads to the deficiency of beta cells, thereby reducing the total insulin hormone levels in the blood. As a result, blood glucose levels abnormally rise and cause the classic symptoms of diabetes. Speaking of symptoms, let's discuss them one by one. So this is our kidney, and as we all know, the functional part of the kidney is called the nephron, where formation of urine takes place. In the nephron, we got the efferent arteriole, which extends into forming the glomerulus, where filtration occurs, and coming out of the glomerulus is the efferent arteriole. Here we have the proximal convoluted tubule, where reabsorption of some filtered substances takes place. The rest of the structures of the nephron are not of much importance to us in our discussion here, so I won't be mentioning them. Anyways, so during filtration, some glucose physiologically gets filtered into the Bowman's capsule. And when that filtrate reaches the proximal convoluted tubule, all of that glucose which is in that filtrate gets reabsorbed back into the blood. In our discussion about diabetes, since we have very high blood glucose levels, the threshold for reabsorbing glucose by the proximal convoluted tubule gets surpassed. And as a result, we get dumping of glucose into the urine, also called glycosuria. So now we know this, let's discuss the other symptoms as well. Here's our blood vessel of a diabetic patient. And remember, in type 1 diabetes, we have high glucose and low insulin levels. Since glucose is osmotically active, during its filtration by the kidneys, water follows glucose. So in addition to glycosuria, you get increased water loss from the kidneys as well. This increased urine output or polyuria can in turn dehydrate the person, urging them to consume more water, also called polydipsia. Poly meaning more, dipsia meaning drinking. Let's move on to the symptoms centered to low insulin levels. Even when glucose levels are high in the blood vessel, it cannot be used by cells for energy because of low insulin levels. So cells of your body starve for energy, and as a response, protein breakdown occurs in the muscles to release amino acids, and fat breakdown occurs in the adipose tissues to release free fatty acids. And both these metabolites can then be used to generate energy. This eventually leads to weight loss, causing the patient to feel hungry, and as a result, eating more food, also called polyphagia. Diagnosing diabetes revolves around getting a sense of how much glucose is roaming around in the blood. Commonly, a fasting blood glucose test is done, where the patient does not eat or drink anything except water for 8 hours and has their blood glucose levels tested. If the levels are below 100 mg per deciliter, it is considered normal. Between 100 to 125 is considered pre-diabetic, and any levels above 126 mg per deciliter are diagnostic of diabetes. Another test that could be done is oral glucose tolerance test. In this test, the patient takes orally a measured bar of glucose. The physician then obtains their blood samples after 2 hours to check how well the body is responding to glucose intake. If the levels are below 140, it is considered normal. Between 140 to 200 is considered pre-diabetic, and levels above 200 are diagnostic of diabetes. Let's move on to our last test, which is the HbA1c test. The idea behind this test is that glucose in the blood can easily go into the red blood cells and cause non-enzymatic glycation of hemoglobin. Specifically, the beta chains of hemoglobin. So measuring the glycated hemoglobin is so-called the HbA1c test. This test can be very useful when monitoring or diagnosing diabetes because the value that we get from this test does not change daily and rather gives an average for the past 3 months, since red blood cells also have a lifespan of 3 months. Let's talk about the values. If the HbA1c levels are below 5.7%, it is considered normal. If the levels are between 5.7 to 6.4%, it is considered pre-diabetic. And any levels above 6.5% are diagnostic of diabetes. That closes off our lecture on type 1 diabetes mellitus. I really hope everything made sense. And if you found this video helpful, please give it a like and comment down in the comment section below. And please make sure to subscribe to our channel.